listen for God's word as it comes through to us through Psalm 96. Oh, sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord, all the earth. Sing to the Lord, bless his name. Tell of his salvation from day to day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous works among all the peoples. For great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised. He is to be revered above all gods, for all the gods of the peoples are idols. But for the Lord made the heavens. Honor and majesty are before him. Strength and beauty are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O families of the peoples. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Bring an offering and come into his courts. Worship the Lord in his holy splendor. Tremble before him, all the earth. Say among the nations, the Lord is king. The world is firmly established. It shall never be moved. He will judge the peoples with equity. Let the heavens be glad, and let the earth rejoice. Let the sea roar, and all that fills it. Let the field exult, and everything in it. Then shall the trees and the forest sing for joy before the Lord, for he is coming, for he is coming to judge the earth. He will judge the world with righteousness and the people with his truth. The word of the Lord.
I want to welcome all the children who are worshiping with us this morning. We're so glad that you're here. For children pre-K through third grade who'd like to attend Godly Play, Miss Katie is right over there. You're welcome to join her. Just come on down. You're also welcome to stay in worship as well. We're glad that you are here this morning, and we pray for you, and we love you very much.
Our second scripture reading this morning comes to us in Philippians chapter 1, verses 1 through 12. Listen again for God's word. Paul and Timothy, servants of Christ Jesus, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God every time I remember you, constantly praying with joy in every one of my prayers for all of you, because of your sharing in the gospel from the first day until now. I am confident of this, that the one who began a good work among you will bring it to completion by the day of Jesus Christ. It is right for me to think this way about all of you, because you hold me in your heart, for all of you share in God's grace with me, both in my imprisonment and the defense and confirmation of the gospel. For God is my witness how I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus. And this is my prayer, that your love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight to help you determine what is best, so that in the day of Christ you may be pure and blameless, having produced the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. I want you to know, beloved, that what has happened to me has actually helped to spread the gospel. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray together. God, we thank you for this written word and your word proclaimed, your living word, Christ among us. We pray that you will open our hearts now so that the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts will be acceptable in your sight, you who are our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. In the past year and a half or so, we've sung all kinds of songs, haven't we? I'm not necessarily talking about actual songs, but maybe a spoken song or a song of your heart, something that helps you cope with the things going on around you, the things happening to you, the things happening to all of us. We have all sung some kind of song with our voice or with our heart during this time, lament for what we have lost, grief over missed milestones, sadness over prolonged separation, frustration over a perception of lack of freedom or real lack of freedom. Yes, we have sung our share of songs of lament in one way or another since about March 2020. For some of us, it's easier to jump to the joyful words of Psalm 96, skipping right over that lament into gratitude and praise to God for all that has been sustained during these difficult times. But I would offer that carrying either lament or joy on their own, one without the other, would keep us from experiencing the full humanity that God created us to experience. Toxic positivity is not the same as joy any more than lament is the same thing as clinical depression. No, both of these things can happen simultaneously, and allowing both joy and lament in all their fullness makes us healthy, balanced, normal human beings. In our Christian worldview, the lament and grief help us process in a healthy way the negative things that have happened to us. Joy is not what helps us escape the lament. Joy is what sustains us through the lament. And that is what Christians call redemption. And that's what we encounter in this letter, in Paul and Timothy's letter to the Philippians today, both lament and joy at the same time. It's not clear whether Paul and Timothy were together or apart, if they were in a prison or house arrest together when this letter was written, but the letter is addressed as if they both endorse these words to their friends in Philippi. Paul, we know, as a Roman citizen, was likely under house arrest rather than in a prison, but even though he was not in an institution, Paul still could not leave. He was isolated, likely very lonely, probably had his letters read and reviewed by those guarding his home, and he also likely needed some form of financial support for food, for supplies, maybe even for bail. He also needed prayers for his spiritual perseverance as he remained unable to encourage and be encouraged by his friends. And nor could they receive Paul's presence among them and encourage him. His letter makes it abundantly clear that he misses his friends in Philippi, and he says from his imprisonment, "How I long for all of you with the compassion of Christ Jesus." At the same time he expresses joy and thanksgiving in his constant prayers, he grieves the inability to worship and fellowship with his friends. I imagine that some of what he really wanted to say may have been held back for fear of what would have been read in his letters, fear of incriminating his friends who were working alongside him in other places. I can't imagine how repressed he must have felt. So as I read this letter, I can hear Paul singing both joy and lament together in the midst of his circumstances. It's not that God necessarily causes these bad things. In fact, more often than not, we human beings cause each other this kind of hardship, putting stumbling blocks in each other's way, preventing each other from experiencing the justice and love of Jesus. Imprisonment, whether in a home or an institution, especially in the first century, was a trying thing indeed, to say the least. So if it had presented great frustration, loneliness, and sadness for Paul, it created equally those things for his loved ones. But in Christ, Paul simultaneously finds joy. His house arrest, imprisonment, or whatever caused or brought it about, his separation from his friends, no matter what brought it about, how actually is helping him spread the good news about what God is doing. God is still faithful, still active, still working for the good of all. God is a God of taking what people intend for harm and creating from the ashes something that seems like nothingness, something good, even holy. And that is what we call redemption. As they remain separated and long to see one another, Paul and Timothy, along with their partners in ministry in Philippi, had to sing a new song to the Lord. They had to sing a redemption song. First, a quick word on this phrase, redemption song. I'm not trying to promote all of Bob Marley's theology, nor am I trying to steal this beautiful phrase meant for a particular people in a particular time and place and culture. I'm simply grateful to the songwriter for offering this phrase to frame our own Christian theology, to look at our own Christian theology and how it relates to the times in which we live now. And we do the same thing with these letters from Paul and his friends to these early Christian churches. We read them in context. We read these letters knowing that they were written to a particular people in a particular time, place, and culture. We don't read these letters as exact prescriptions for solving the checklist of problems in our church today. We read them as models, ways of understanding and responding to the obstacles the church has always faced. What doesn't change is that we face trials and tribulations both as individuals and as a body, but what does change is the context, the time, place, circumstances, and culture. So we delve into this letter from Paul and Timothy, knowing that their time, place, culture, and circumstances were very different from those we face now, and yet there is a common thread. We find ourselves homebound a lot of the time these days, though not fully under house arrest. We're kind of waiting for this day when we can rip off our masks and gather with friends and family and do what we want to do without fear of spreading a deadly or debilitating virus. Our circumstances are but a loose corollary to those of Paul and Timothy, but in their letters we hear them singing a redemption song not too far off from what we are singing now. Paul and Timothy's letter to their friends provides an example to us of how to sing a redemption song when we are separated from our Christian family. The redemption song is a song of longing to see loved ones, a song of gratitude for the perseverance of the saints, a song of hope for the day when God will make all things new. In a Christian context, Paul uses the occasion of his letter to thank the Philippians for helping him sing this song of freedom, this redemption song. He sings of gratitude for their faith and perseverance, for their sharing in the good news with him. He sings a prayer with them in joy. And this song is not a generic form letter that Paul and Timothy wrote. It's not a letter sent out en masse to their mission supporters. It's not a template from Microsoft Word in which the computer automatically replaces the name and address of each recipient. No, Paul and Timothy visited Philippi before, and we read about it in Acts 16. They met Lydia there, who started a house church and helped spread the gospel in Philippi. They also met a young slave girl whom they liberated from those exploiting her. Those who exploited her had Paul and Silas flogged and thrown in prison, but the guard of the prison that watched those doors open was so moved by what God had done that Paul and Silas baptized him and his entire household. And then after they walked out of the prison, they went back to visit Lydia and her church to visit them and encourage them in their ministry. So it's not unlikely that those whom Paul and Timothy directed their letter to Philippi included Lydia, included that prison guard, and maybe even that slave girl they helped liberate. There are faces, names, and stories behind those they yearn to see. They know the strong faith of these people quite well and pray for their partners in ministry, despite their inability to visit them in person. It's not only a thank you letter for the funds Paul has received for food and supplies and maybe bail. It is a letter of friendship, encouragement, and relationship as siblings in Christ. It's a letter for friends whose faces they can see in their mind's eye, whose voices they can hear in their memory, whose hands they have held in prayer. The letter sings a redemption song to real people who are actively encouraging and strengthening them, holding them in prayer, who are singing that redemption song along with them in another distant place. Jamaican poet and University of Michigan professor Emerita Lorna Goodison says of redemption, "I am always drawn to stories in human history in which someone is redeemed. Instances where a debt owed is canceled, when some good soul comes forward and pays off the bond price that sets the indebted free. As I have not found many such stories of redemption in the history of my own people, redemption has become my key word, and I am hoping that in time others will join me on the redemption train." Bob Marley wrote a song inspired by the words of one of the world's great freedom fighters, Marcus Garvey. The song is called Redemption Song, and it has become an anthem for people all over the world. Implied in the words is the plea for us all to help sing, to write redemption songs, songs and stories for the rest of my life. This is what I hope to be doing. Isn't this what Jesus calls us to do? Jesus, our Redeemer, is calling us to write redemption songs and stories for the rest of our lives here on earth, in Paul's words, to share in God's grace, and for the age to come, again in Paul's words, to bring the good work within us to completion. So in this present age of pandemic, mass migration, political upheaval, and power grabbing, not too far off from the age in which the song Redemption Song was written, and not too far off of the age in which Paul and Timothy wrote this letter to the Philippians either, how do we write our own redemption songs for here, now, and today? We are all experiencing some form of pandemic restrictions, whether legally, socially, or personally imposed. So we're all in this sort of house arrest-ish together, writing modern versions of letters and friendship and encouragement to one another as we go along. And as you can imagine, I'm thinking particularly about our global mission partners whom we would normally be visiting around the world, especially as we worship here today to celebrate those partnerships. On a personal level, many Sunday mornings I wake up to a WhatsApp message from a pastor in Kenya who prays for me as I participate in leading worship. I receive pictures from our partners in Cuba distributing food to the seniors in their community, and their prayer requests as well. I receive news from Haiti via Laganov Haiti Partners. I receive newsletters from the United Church of Jamaica and the Cayman Islands and words of friendship and encouragement from an elder of that denomination who shares my last name. I receive emails from our friends in Fortaleza, Brazil, and share in the joy of the young adults at the Messejana Church there as they post their Instagram photos of graduating from college and moving on to the next steps of their vocational discernment. And on a congregational level, those same young adults have been meeting regularly with our 20s and 30s group on Zoom during this time. We have members of our church who provide simultaneous Portuguese and English interpretation for those gatherings. Can you imagine? Our partners in Jamaica have gathered online with our youth a few times this year as well, and our partners in Kenya have been joining our subcommittee meetings on Zoom. With increased internet access, we're receiving more pictures and news from our friends in Cuba than we ever did before. And then today, we sing new songs to the Lord in worship, songs from countries where our partners live, songs in languages that our partners speak. We pray prayers from the hearts of those people, those who encourage us in our faith. And they are not people writing form letters to us, thanking us for our financial support during our absence, even though we know they are grateful for that. And we're not people writing form letters to them either, writing token phrases, praising them for their steadfast faith. We're singing songs of redemption. We're singing songs to people we know, whose faces are imprinted in our mind's eye, whose voices resound in our memory, who were on video in our 9:30 service this morning, those who have held our hands in prayer. These are people who have joined this Christian family, their Christian family, in Bible study, prayer, and fellowship online, even during these difficult times, even with people who have not yet or may not ever travel to see them. These are people who are singing songs of redemption with us, and these are the songs that we sing in these difficult days. This is the new song we are singing to the Lord. Truly, in the redemption of our time spent physically apart, God has redeemed and done wonders. We do all these things so that our love may overflow more and more with knowledge and full insight, producing a harvest of righteousness as we interact with our global partners, as we encounter people of varying cultures in our own city through our local global mission partnerships, as we prepare to welcome new Americans from Afghanistan, and as we learn how to be better stewards of the human diversity with which God has richly blessed this earth. Even as we are bound to protect each other by not traveling to see our partners right now, our Christian family, our partners in other countries around the world are encouraging us through their letters of faith in this liturgy before us today, in this music, in these prayers. In this worship, we and our partners remember each other, thank God for each other, and continue to share in the gospel with one another. We celebrate communion today, as many of our partners will, knowing that this table is God's table, where people gather even today from north, south, east, and west to feast in God's realm together. We are singing God's redemption together. We are living out God's promise of redemption together. This very worship service is sharing in the gospel, the harvest of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ for the glory and praise of God. What has happened to us in this past year has actually helped to spread the gospel. This is the redemption song we sing together. Amen.